Welcome to my next in my series of college writing tips. I don't think in my other ones I introduced myself. This is Michael Busby, and I'm the Constant Geographer on YouTube. And so I'd like to thank everybody for listening, for watching these videos, and paying attention to what I have to say. I've been teaching since 1993, more or less. Officially since 1997, but I've had a few years of graduate teaching assistantship behind me, and so when we include all of those things, I've got a pretty good amount of teaching behind me. And so one of my objectives for creating these writing tips, again, to kind of summarize what I've said in some other videos, is to help you become more successful in your writing. Writing is very important in society. I recently had a discussion with a fellow who's worked for a number of nonprofit organizations, and one of the things that he impressed upon me is that when you write, you're basically selling yourself. You're communicating to somebody in a very brief amount of time how organized you are, how well you think, what you think about, the types of things that are important to you, and sometimes that's all you have is one sheet or maybe two sheets of paper that you present to somebody, or maybe it's your website that you're trying to present to someone, and that's basically your foot in the door. And so that's really what I want to try to impress upon people is by writing, you're communicating who you are to your audience. In college, your audience can tend to be your professor, but you don't want to put yourself in a position and trap yourself in that mentality that, oh, I'm just writing this for my professor. You want to present this, you want to think about this, and you want to frame everything that you do is, how do I put my best foot forward? How do I create a document, and how do I create a portion of myself that best represents myself, whether it's a simple paragraph on an exam, it's a research paper, a short essay, an editorial in a newspaper. Writing comes into play when you have to write a resume cover letter. You know, usually you write a resume cover letter. It's one page, but that's where that's your foot in the door. And if your resume cover letter is full of errors, full of grammatical mistakes, and just problems that manifest themselves in all sorts of different ways, your resume is not going to make it to the top of the stack. Your resume is most likely going to end up in a B or C pile. And you're not going to get a call back because the amount of effort that you put into your cover letter, for example, tends to be indicative of, I mean, it may not even be indicative of who you are as a person, but that's what those people are going to see, and you don't want them to see that. You also want to make sure that you specifically address the topics, whether it's a cover letter, whether it's a business pitch, a business plan, you know, whatever it might be, you really want to make sure you focus on what's important. And that's why that's why I created these writing tips, is to help coach people who need to write, whether it's for an academic class or whether it's later on after you've graduated, to help coach you into writing better. So that you can be more successful. So today we're talking about point values. One of the things that I noticed from grading, and I've been teaching at the college level since, like I said, 1997, I have many kinds of students. It's just not college, you know, what you would think of as your typical college student. I teach high school students. I've got high school students in class. I have adults that are back in college. I have retired people. I have service people coming back from overseas. I have new immigrants. I have new people right out of high school. It's essentially the gamut of people. And so, I see a lot of trends. I see a lot of bad habits. I don't think anybody is particularly, nobody who's in education really is, I don't want to say stupid, but they just don't, you know, they just haven't been coached very well over the course of their academic career or their personal lives, or maybe they initially thought that college wasn't for them and now it has to be for them. And so you really have to set aside your mindset, and in some cases set aside your ego, and take a step down approach and really listen to the criticism that's coming across, because criticism is not a bad thing. We all take in criticism. We all, you know, give off criticism when we see things that need to be fixed or repaired. And so, you know, sometimes we have to set aside our emotional response to that so we can really get to the heart of the matter. So this morning I'm talking about point values. One of the things that I find often is students don't pay attention to the point values on a problem. You know, usually we look at a point value, and if they're given on an exam, which hopefully they are in most cases, we don't want to spend as much time on a one-point question as a 10-point or a 20-point. Hopefully there's not a 50-point, but I've had 50-point essay questions on college exams. You know, usually it's an all-writing exam like you'd find in a history class or maybe a psychology class or something like that. So you need to pay attention to point values. You can't treat a 5-point exam question the same way you would treat a 15-point exam question. By the way, the comments and the essays that I'm talking about here, you can find those on constantgeography.com on my blog that I maintain for talking about general higher education related issues and concerns. If you search for April 2013 and May 2013, you'll find these essays in a form on my Constant Geography blog. When I give writing assignments, I vary points. Questions worth 2 points don't require much effort, really. You know, maybe it's define this word. A telltale question typically could have been answered with a single word. You don't usually want to use phrases, because most faculty, what they want to see a fully formed sentence. Phrases and bullet points and enumerated lists. They seem to be coming out of high school wanting to do those things, and those aren't really acceptable for college unless specifically stated in the directions. So something along the lines of a short 2-point question might be something like, define the environmental lapse rate. And you would want to respond with something like the environmental lapse rate refers to the change in temperature as a function of altitude within a given column of air. In a geography class, you might be posed with the question, define devolution. Devolution refers to a small group or groups of disaffected people who seek some form of autonomy from a federal government. And so that's basically what you would simply put down for a 2-point answer. Anything less than that, if you put a phrase down, or, you know, I know people go through some test anxiety once in a while. There are certain things you can do to work against that. Maybe I need to make some videos that discuss how to reduce your test anxiety. But anything less than a full sentence that kind of describes this, you're going to lose points on. So you want to be aware of those things. More detailed questions are going to be awarded more points, and so that basically tells you that you're going to have to work harder. So you'll want to use terminology. You're going to want to use the lingo that I talked about in a previous video. You're going to want to think about and use examples that you read about in the text, or maybe saw in a video, listened to in a podcast. You're going to want to bring to bear the evidence that this course provided you. So an example of a higher point value question might be something like, identify and discuss 3 regions within the United Kingdom which illustrate the phenomenon of devolution. So in a previous question, we had you define what devolution is, and now the next question is, okay, now that we've defined it, tell me about 3 places in the United Kingdom where devolution might exist. So you're going to want to identify where these places are, and then you're going to perhaps, because it does say discuss, why devolution might be occurring in these regions. So you're going to have to provide evidence. Is it economic problems? Is it lack of political identification? Is there a language issue? You're going to want to dig back and figure out the reasons for this. And so in a lot of cases, the exams are about the informational content of the course, but you want to think about this in the bigger picture as well, too, is how are you approaching the problem? Because that's really what employers are looking for, is how do you identify the problem? How do you identify outcomes, solutions to the problem, and how are you going to cross the gap between the recognition of the problem and the real cause of the problem and the resolution. You know, what's going to be that process in between there? That's what employers are really looking for. Can you think outside the box? How do you address problem solving? So the initial, what I would call the proximate problem, the near problem, is, yeah, you got to answer this question on the exam. But the distal problem, the overarching problem, is what tools am I going to bring to bear that will help take me from A to B? So you want to make sure that you pay attention to point values on a quiz or a homework assignment. There really should be no mystery. If something says discuss, and you know that from the material that you've read that, wow, we spent a day talking about this, you're going to have to put some work into it. And if you don't put work into it, you're not going to be rewarded with very many points, if any points. Regardless of how a learning management system, and a learning management system, an LMS like Canvas or Blackboard or Edmodo, regardless of how those things are classified within the learning management system, you need to pay attention to really what's going on there, because, you know, some learning management systems will say, well, this is a short answer. But maybe that's not what the faculty person intended. It simply, the way the LMSs tend to work is they give you a set of tools to use, and so sometimes those tools don't lend themselves well for the assignment, and so the instructor sort of has to adjust their assignment based on what the learning management system gives them. And so sometimes, you know, if you want a short answer, you know, but you want to give the students some leeway and in space, essentially, then what you would do is you would set that up as an essay. And so it might come up as an essay in the learning management system, but the instructions say this is a short answer. So make sure you pay attention to the information that your instructor provides you. Always review an exam before you begin the exam. Look for short answers, look for essay questions, make a note of them. Plan out your strategy for taking the exam. Plan on spending more time on essays, less time on the short answers. Consider the time you have available, then balance that effort across the exam. Don't simply just jump into it. As I've said on some other videos, you know, sometimes we deliberately put information in the exam that will help you complete other portions of the exam. But students are so wound up, you know, because of test anxiety, they don't really see these things. And so that's where, you know, having some good prep time, you know, anticipating what the questions might be. One of the exercises I have my students go through once in a while is I have them make their own test questions. And then I use those test questions as my pool of test questions from which I make the exam from. And so since they're the ones making the exam questions, they sort of know what's going to be on the exam. And if they get together and they share stuff, you know, sometimes that's a good thing, because they're all thinking about, you know, what makes good exam questions, how do I create the question, how do I create appropriate responses. They have to go through and scrutinize the material a little more. And so sometimes that's a good exercise just to do on your own. If I were teaching this class, what things would I be looking for? You know, what would make a good essay question? What did we spend a lot of time on? What is there a lot of background material on? Those types of things. And so when you go through and plan like that, then you're able to go through and say, you know what, I've planned pretty well for this exam, and I've spent some time on it, and I think I'll probably do pretty good. I appreciate your time this morning. I'm shooting this in Murray, Kentucky, and it's a pleasant day, which is why I'm outside. So I do appreciate questions and comments on YouTube. I do moderate those because there's too much nonsense on the comments section on YouTube. But I do read my emails that I get, and I appreciate those emails. And in the future, I might do some video responses to any kind of emails that I get as well, too, because I do enjoy communicating and kind of revealing what goes on in higher education. So thank you for watching my channel.